Australia is without a doubt a highly successful nation. They are 9th on the GDP per capita list, number 8 on the Human Development Index, and number 12 on the Human Happiness Index. But more impressively, they have avoided recession for 28 years straight, from 1992 to 2020. But beneath all of this economic success lies a concerning truth. You see, there is a reason why Australia has been able to achieve this economic success, and that is Australia's number one trading partner, China. China's economy has, coincidentally, also grown rapidly in the last few decades. Take the Great Recession in 2008 as an example, where the rest of the developed world was struggling. China was still growing, and it was therefore still looking to import things like iron ore, natural gas, and coal to build more cities and fuel its growth. Australia had plenty of these resources to sell, and especially iron ore, while also having a significant geographic advantage that other nations didn't, as it is located south of China, with an easily navigable ocean between them. This became Australia's ticket to economic success, and since then, they've had no problem with increasing their exports to China. And while that might very well be the simplest route to take, it's also one that brings considerable concerns. Take a look at this chart. It shows the countries that Australia has exported the most to, from 1992 to 2012, and you can clearly see a massive increase in exports to China compared to other countries like Japan, South Korea, and India. But the chart is a bit old, as it only has data up until 2012. So here's another graph that exclusively shows Australia's exports to China from 2006 to 2019. Here you can clearly see the massive increase in exports to China, and this is what eventually led to China accounting for a whopping 43% of Australia's total exports in 2020. Now, Australia's GDP consists of a lot more than just exports, considering 22% of the country's GDP is made up of exports, but it's still not insignificant, as it means that China has direct control over 10% of Australia's economy through exports alone. But interestingly, exports are not the only thing China is taking over. They also have a massive influence on the goods that get imported to the land down under. In fact, China has complete monopoly on some crucial product categories. For example, UN data shows that Australia is 100% dependent on China for supplies of manganese, crucial for the production of stainless steel and other alloys. And considering the construction industry generates over $360 billion in revenue, producing around 9% of Australia's GDP, and has a projected annual growth rate of 2.4% in the next 5 years, it's worrying to say the least. But there is another industry China has a near monopoly on, and that is agriculture. And in this industry, you need a few but very key ingredients that include, but are not limited to, land, water, seeds, and fertilizers. And if any of these key ingredients, for one reason or the other, is missing in the calculation, you won't be able to successfully farm anything. This is why it might come as a shock to you that more than 90% of Australia's fertilizers come from China, meaning that Australia is almost entirely dependent on China to keep this industry alive, that accounts for around 3% of its GDP. I think you get the picture. Australia depends quite a lot on China. But why is this a problem? Well, in normal circumstances, when two countries with similar political views, similarly sized economies, and a good relationship trade a lot with each other, it really isn't a problem at all. However, when these factors are close to non-existent, like they are in the case of Australia and China, it can bring a lot of problems. And unfortunately, Australia's relationship with China is not a happy one at the moment, as a result of Australia's push for answers regarding the pandemic's origins, which has angered the CCP, and in the past few months it has put some bruising sanctions and travel warnings in place to show this. An example of this is the recent barley tariffs. Barley is used in beer and pig feed, and it's a grain that Australia produced over 8 million tons of in 2019. And in that same year, China bought more than half of this Australian-produced barley, at a premium price, which has made Australian barley farmers quite wealthy. But in May of last year, China imposed an 80% tariff on Australian-produced barley. It came, as you now know, after Canberra called for an investigation into COVID-19's origins, a move that the CCP labelled politically motivated. China has since suspended some major Australian beef imports and warned students as well as tourists against travelling to the, as they described it, racist country. And in June last year, in a secretive process, it sentenced an Australian man to death for drug smuggling. So it seems that China is willing to pull in any strings it has available in order to force Australia to comply with and support Chinese political views. This is what can happen when the factors I mentioned earlier, like similar political views and similarly sized economies, are not in place. But the concerning thing about these recent sanctions is that China pulled in one of the smallest strings it has available, considering barley is only the 8th most exported product from Australia, which means they have a lot of strings left to pull that are vastly more crucial to the Australian economy. And the most important of these strings is Australia's iron ore exports. You see, if China decides to put similar tariffs on that, it will crumble Australia's mining industry and send the country into a way deeper recession than the one it's currently experiencing due to the COVID-19 pandemic. And one thing is for certain, Australia would not survive a trade war with China, and especially not one on the scale that China is having with the United States right now. But this is exactly what China's goal has been this whole time. The more reliant Australia becomes on China, the less likely it is that Australia would object to anything China says or does. Essentially, China has created a forced ally, which has put Australia in a bit of an odd position, considering that Australia has wildly different political views from China. It seems inevitable that a trade war would eventually happen, especially when you take Australia's actual allies into consideration, as they would probably not be too happy about Australia either sitting on the sidelines or even supporting China when it comes to political discussions. So what can Australia do to escape this firm grip China has on its economy? Well, there's really only one option that Australia has, but it has its downsides. This option is diversification, which is pretty self-explanatory. Just shift the exports from China to another country. But that is easier said than done, as the likelihood of this actually succeeding is quite low. The reason for this is that you can't really disguise a shift in the countries you export to, as it's pretty simple for China to figure out what is going on by simply looking in their order books, where Australia would obviously be missing. Even a gradual shift wouldn't work, as that would also be obvious to spot. But that's not even the most difficult part of diversifying a country's exports, considering the government also has to somehow either force or convince the Australian companies to export their goods to other countries like India and Japan, who might not need an extra $50 billion worth of iron ore. And to be quite frank, no country on earth needs that much iron, making it an impossible task for the Australian companies to deal with. But I still haven't told you the biggest problem of them all. The thing that prevents diversification from happening is the very thing that created the need to diversify in the first place, and that is China. Whenever China finds out that Australia is beginning to redirect its exports to other countries, it might start pulling on a few strings again to get Australia back in line. And it's likely that China would pull on strings that will have a much bigger effect on the Australian economy, as it's obviously in China's best interest to keep Australia exactly where they are. But even though diversification will most definitely bring a major economic downturn for Australia, it's their only option, and if they don't take it, much worse things could happen. Not only will China have complete control over their economy, they will also have control over their politics, which is not something Australia or its allies would want, as this means that Australia will either have to sit on the sidelines or agree with China's political views when international political debates are to take place. So if Australia wants to keep its allies as well as its political views, it will have to take the fight with China at some point and figure out a plan to survive without them, which is most certainly a difficult thing to do. But what isn't so difficult is subscribing, as only a small percentage of those who are watching these videos are actually subscribed. So consider subscribing, it's free and you can always change your mind.